We'll just wait a few minutes, a couple of minutes for our stragglers to come in, if you'd bear with us. Well, why don't we get started? Good morning, dear friends and colleagues. My name is Bobo Lo, and it's my great pleasure and honor to moderate this session on visions of China. Now, at a time when we're understandably focused on what is happening in Ukraine, what it means for the European order and European security and even global order, it's easy to forget that there are a whole bunch of issues and priorities that are incredibly important. And I would argue that one of the most important is the rise of an increasingly globalist, assertive, and self-confident China. I think it is truly one of the great challenges, not necessarily threats, but one of the great challenges of our century. And so what we wanted to do with this Lennart Meri panel was to get a wide but also intimate perspective on China, looking at it through the lens of some of its neighbors in the Asia Pacific region. And today we are going to listen to insights from America, India, Singapore, and Australia. And so this segues nicely into introducing our wonderful panelists. To my immediate left, Bonnie Glaser, Director of the Asia Program at the German Marshall Fund. Next to her, Raja Mohan, who's Senior Fellow at the Asia Society Policy Institute in New Delhi. Next to Raja is Eng Hen Nguyen, Minister of Defense at the Republic of Singapore. And finally, to the far left is Natasha Kassam, Director, Public Opinion and Foreign Policy at the Lowy Institute in Australia. So what I wanted to do was to kickstart our discussion by putting a few broad questions to our panelists, but also to you in the audience. So my first question to you all is, what is China's endgame? Is Xi Jinping committed to global domination and overturning the international order? Or are China's goals somewhat more modest, still ambitious, of course, but somewhat more modest, whereby China seeks to be a global leader rather than the global leader and seeks primacy in the Asia-Pacific or Indo-Pacific region? And this raises another question of, can China change or be changed? Or do you think its sense of self-entitlement will increase as its powers grow? My second question is, what impact, if any, has the Russian invasion of Ukraine had on Beijing's strategic calculus? Will the lessons, the spectacle of Russian failures actually serve to moderate Chinese ambitions in relation to, say, Taiwan, the South China Sea, the Sino-Indian border? And what are the implications for the Sino-Russian partnership? Speaking of which, a lot has been said, including yesterday, about an alliance or an axis of authoritarians. The Australian Prime Minister, Scott Morrison, spoke about an arc of autocracy. Now, is this a useful way to look at the Sino-Russian partnership, or do such constructs get in the way of understanding the subtleties and nuances of this partnership? And to our panelists specifically, how do you see your country's relationship with China evolving over the next few years? Do you anticipate growing tensions? And if so, to what extent? Or do you think it's actually possible to achieve some kind of accommodation? I think the former Australian Prime Minister Kevin Rudd spoke about managed competition. Is that possible? And is it possible to develop cooperation with China in selected areas, say, for example, climate policy. And finally, and this is a more general question for us to consider, are we moving to a new world order? And if so, what shape will it take? Or are we destined to live in a kind of Hobbesian dystopia, a kind of new world disorder? Or perhaps the Ukraine war will serve to revitalize the concept of a rules-based international order. So, Bonnie, why don't you get the ball rolling?
Well, thank you, Bobo, and good to be here with you all. That's a lot of questions, and I think you've given me about 5 minutes, so I will pick up on a few. I'll start by saying that I think that powers, as they rise and they amass power, tend to become more ambitious. So even if you think China does not want to be the world's leading global superpower today, it may nonetheless evolve to have that ambition in the future. But there is no doubt today that China sees itself as more than just a regional power and the dominant regional power in the Asia Pacific. And we need to look no further than the Boao Forum for Asia that just took place, where Xi Jinping launched what he is calling a global security initiative. I don't think we really know what this means yet. It's sort of like the Belt and Road Initiative that was rolled out in 2013, and then researchers and officials put meat on the bones and became, I think, quite significant subsequently. We also saw Xi Jinping launch the Global Development Initiative at the United Nations last September. So China definitely has global ambitions. But I would caution against seeing China as wanting to be the same kind of global superpower as the United States is. The Chinese are fond of saying they don't want to be the world policeman, and I think indeed they do not. But I think that they do have ambitions to be a global leader and perhaps the global leader. I think one of the most significant factor that influences and shapes China's own foreign policy is how it assesses the balance of power, particularly between the United States and China. And the Chinese increasingly see the United States as a power in decline and China as a power on the rise. And we hear this from Chinese. There's a saying, the East is rising and the West is declining. So if that assessment continues, then I think actually changing that ambition or even changing China, I think, is really very difficult. For the United States, what we seek to do, and this was a line in the Indo-Pacific strategy that was released by the Biden administration just about a month or so ago, was that the United States seeks to shape the strategic environment around China. And to do that along with allies and partners. So there is not an explicit goal of seeking to change China, which I think, in fact, there was during the Trump administration. So there really is a hope that perhaps we can shape China's choices. And then the last thing that I'll say is in regard to the impact of the Ukraine war on China's strategic calculus, which I think it's a little bit too early to draw conclusions. After all, the war is still ongoing. But the early conclusions that I suspect that China has drawn is that having conventional military advantage doesn't necessarily deliver you an easy victory. And of course, if we're talking about Taiwan, then China has to transport significant capability across 100 miles of water. An amphibious landing operation would be difficult. And if Taiwan learns the lessons of resistance, then it will be even more difficult than I think that the PLA had anticipated. But the outcome that we have seen of the international community imposing sanctions on Russia, I think, has surprised China, particularly the depth and breadth of those sanctions. And this is something the Chinese are studying now because they want to insulate themselves against those kinds of sanctions in the future. So I hope that this war is inducing a sense of caution in Beijing.
Okay. That's a great answer. I wanted to follow up with a question, if I may, though. One of the reasons that the Chinese give for not dumping Russia in the Ukraine crisis is that where else would they go? They would face a strategic confrontation eventually with the United States, isolated. So you would have a degraded relationship with Russia. You would have a confrontation with the United States. This is from Beijing's perspective. An increasingly adversarial Europe, and also surrounded by unfriendly neighbors, Japan, Vietnam, even South Korea now. So the thing is, what can the United States, how can the United States incentivize China to be a more cooperative player? So can the United States, any administration, whether it's Democratic or Republican, can they say to China, there really is an opportunity to create, well, yes, it'll be a competitive relationship, but a more cooperative, more productive interaction between the United States and China. Is that feasible?
Well, certainly from the time that the Biden administration came to power and there were discussions at senior levels between U.S. and Chinese officials, I think the United States made clear that there are different pathways that China can take. And it looks to me like China has doubled down in many ways on a pathway of challenging American interests, of undermining the rules-based international order, of intimidating its neighbors in the region, increasing military coercion against Taiwan, continuing to build anti-access area denial capabilities in the region, and pursuing policies that are very much, I think, against the interests of our allies in Europe. So the Chinese have made this choice. And
do you think they can unmake this choice, at least to some extent, learning the lessons of Russia's failures in the Ukraine crisis? Do you retain any optimism on that score?
I'm very pessimistic, and I think that the fact that the Chinese have so far not provided any material support to the Russian economy or to the Russian military effort is not because they're trying to distance themselves from Moscow, but because they don't want to face the consequences themselves of doing so. So they are not neutral. They are not, it's just independent, as they say. I think they are they have doubled down on a very pro-Russia position, and I doubt that they will change.
Okay. Roger Mohan, I'm going to ask you, let's start off with, since we're talking about functional and dysfunctional relationships, is there any chance that China and India can redevelop a more or less functional relationship that they had pre-1962?
The idea of an ambitious, functional, not just functional, but a real cooperative relationship between India and China has been one of the ambitions of India. And that goes back to 1927, before we were independent, in Brussels. There was this anti-imperialist congress that, you know, many European ideas, you know, continue to shape us. That was the first formal meeting between the Indian nationalists and the Chinese nationalists. And they met Jawaharlal Nehru himself, was in Brussels. And they issued a statement, first joint statement, almost like two governments, in waiting to take over the post-war Asia. There were two core ideas. One, we will make Asia different from the West. And the two, we can together shape a new world. There are large ancient civilizations, all that stuff, that we're going to remake the world on the base of our rising capabilities, that is China and India. It's one of those grand ambitions that continuously fell short because the reality kept intruding. First, the idea of Asian unity, that broke down pretty quickly because India and China had a territorial conflict and a conflict over Tibet within 10 years after independence. So there we were trying to build a relationship. But the fact that we have quarrels between ourselves, that shattered this myth of an Asia that is united against the West. Yeah. And in fact, much of our story has been when they were close to the West, we were against the West. When we are getting close to the West, they're against the West. So this idea that Asia versus the West, I think, is one of the greatest fallacies.
Yeah.
Because within Asia, there are contradictions. And one of the biggest contradictions in Asia is one between India and China. Mm. And that despite repeated efforts at building a functional relationship, we've ended up in conflict. And I think that's the tragedy of the relationship, whether it was in the 1950s or in the 1990s, when India and China were both afraid of the unipolar moment.
Yeah.
We came together with our Russian friends to say, we will build a multipolar world.
Yeah.
But today, India fears a unipolar Asia that is dominated by China.
Mm.
So we're looking to the West to make sure Asia is not unipolar. So this is all the old stereotypes of how this works are fundamentally broken. But I also want to address a second question, that in the end, China is next door to us. It's not something we can wish away.
Yeah.
Despite a series of military crises, including the most serious one in 2020, India is negotiating with China. 15 rounds of military talks that have gone on. Mm. So we have to live with China. So irrespective of what happens in China, that we can't wish away China, and they can't wish away India as well. So we are there. So that brings me to the third question, which you said, which is, can China change? And I think here I see two big mistakes being made here in Europe, in North America as well. One, to identify China with Xi Jinping, as if the two are interrelated, as if there is no other politics in China, that it is just like Putin in Russia. China's Chinese Communist Party has always had politics, had always had factions, had always had different lines. Just because Xi Jinping is strong today doesn't mean he's going to be strong 1 week later, 2 weeks down the road, 4 weeks down the road, or at the end of the party congress. So I think we should not conflate the two. Second, I think framing China in autocracy terms is, again, I think, because it's a nice slogan, headline, easy to politicians to say these things. But US had no problem dealing with the Deng Xiaoping's China, which is not threatening anybody, which was telling Wall Street and the Silicon Valley, come and make money, guys. If you want to make money, come to China. Everybody loved it. So it is the kind of policies Xi Jinping has pursued that has created the conflict between him. You could be an autocracy inside and yet be friend of the West. We know that history. So I think we should look to focus on China's internal evolution, which I think there will be significant changes, because in the end, change is the only constant in life. And for our job is to see how we can get there to deal with other groups in China that could be more open to living with Asia's neighbors in Asia, as well as the other major powers in Europe and the United States. And I think that must be our long-term goal, to be have a productive relationship with China.
So you think it is actually feasible that China may return to some form of Dengism, Deng Xiaopingism, so that it's essentially a pragmatic version of authoritarianism? Because there's an opposing view which says that Deng only advocated hiding your light under a bushel because simply China wasn't that developed and that powerful at that time. Whereas some 15 years later, two decades later, it is so much more powerful, and that if Deng were living today, he might actually not really be a great advocate of hiding your light under a bushel. So I just wonder how much variation there is within the ruling elite in China, within the Chinese Communist Party.
I'm sure whether it's return to Dengism or some other ism, that Xi Jinping is not immortal, right? I mean, he's not here forever.
No.
So my sense is, what I know of modern Chinese history is that every single Chinese leader, things were different.
Yeah.
Mao was one thing. Mao had probably two phases. You had Deng Xiaoping, you had Xi Jinping. I mean, the policies were different. So this idea that is a monolithic China that's going to simply, keep doing the same thing it is doing, that is exactly the opposite. Change has been significant, often violent and dramatic, from being an ally of the Communist Soviet Union to an ally of the United States. It's done all kinds of things. So I think what we need is, look, it is not, again, I think framing it in autocracy terms diverts your attention, that is it a threat to you or not? Some Chinese policies are a threat to its Asian neighbors.
Yeah.
Exactly the kind of thing Xi Jinping is doing, like just like Putin, wants more territory. For a country of that size and of that wealth today, seeking more territory, which is almost like a peasant-like attitude, which is where, here is China, number two economy, one of the largest economies, and they're you go after territory. And I think that has fended off Japan, which has maritime disputes, India, which has the disputes in the Himalayas. They have rattled two of the neighbors for what?
Yeah.
So I think this is where Xi Jinping's worldview, which has created problems, not just between US and America, but between US, China, and its neighbors.
Absolutely, It's interesting that you caution against associating, having simplistic schemes like autocracies versus democracies, because this is, I want to move to Defense Minister at this stage, because your Prime Minister, Lee Hsien Loong, is on record in an interview with the Wall Street Journal as criticizing this idea of dividing the world between autocracies or authoritarian regimes on the one hand and democracies on the other. You know, the sort of Biden's great inflection point. He, your prime minister, says that this is actually very unhelpful. So I would be interested in if you could develop that thought and anything else that you think would be of particular relevance.
Thank you, Bobo. I think the Prime Minister's comments stand for themselves, but they are framed along the lines, I think, which both Bonnie Glaser and Raja Mohan have talked about, which is how do you deal with China? But before I touch that, and I will, I thought your opening comments framed a number of issues, but I wanted to focus on one core issue, which is in this conference, and I suspect many more because of the Ukraine invasion by Russia, is what happens to the world order? How do we operate? What does it mean? How does it change? And I wanted to give a perspective of small states, different from the US, India, and Australia. And I think small states are primarily concerned with stability, that the international rules protect the interests of small countries and not only the large. I reminded a quote of by Mr. Lee Kuan Yew, our founding prime minister, that says that there was no international law and order, and if big fish ate small fish and small fish ate shrimp, then Singapore wouldn't exist. And mea culpa, we are shrimp, the size. Singapore is, Estonia is 60 times the size of Singapore.
Wow. That's quite.
So we are a very small shrimp.
Excellent.
We understand that small states don't have the wherewithal to construct the global domains, the international rules of the world, as it were. But there have been times where Singapore chose to speak out to the international community to preserve the international order. And one such moment was February the 28th this year, 4 days after the invasion. Our government issued a condemnation of Russia's quote-unquote unprovoked military invasion of Ukraine. We made clear that it was a clear and gross violation of international law, which was an existential issue for small countries. And ahead of the UN or ahead of other countries, we applied targeted sanctions to Russia to constrain Russia's capacity to wage war against Ukraine. We also co-sponsored a UN General Assembly resolution, which introduced a new requirement for a General Assembly meeting to be convened automatically in wake of any US Security Council veto, which did come. So Singapore's recent actions underscore our strongest commitment to the preservation of sovereignty, political independence, and territorial integrity, which we believe is a fundamental bedrock for a free and stable world order and smaller countries' right to survive and thrive. And in that context, I'll answer the question on China, this panel's focus, as well as the question that Bobo raised. What is China's view? And we've all touched upon that, different facets of what we perceive as China's view. And if I had a wish, I would have wished that there would have been a Chinese representative, but because who else better than to have a China's view than from China? But anyway. So Our starting point is over the past 70 years of globalization, China has benefited. And it has recognized that these benefits have accrued to countries across the spectrum of political ideology, from autocracies to liberal democracies. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. There was never any debate, as you rightly pointed out, about what ideology was this. So when the Clinton administration pushed for China to accede to the WTO, which we constantly remind China, it wasn't, are you ideologically pure enough, like the US, to join the WTO? Mm. It was never on that preface and never on that eligibility criteria. Now, China wants to preserve the global commons, coming to the question of what is China's view on the international order. Not only to preserve the global commons of trade and commerce and other systems, but to strengthen it. In President Xi's own words, he wants to lead the reform for the global governance system, quote-unquote, whatever that means. What motivates China? I think China's starting point is that it has gained from the current international system. And I would quickly add that its impact on the world, whether it's trade, commerce, finance, is much larger than Russia. The US economy is now about a quarter of the global GDP. China, astonishingly, has grown from 2% of global GDP in 1990, 30 years ago, to 17%, more than an eightfold rise. Just another metric, China has over 1,100 billionaires, more than the US, UK, and India. Not bad for an economy run by the Chinese Communist Party. And a middle class of 400 million. There are opportunities, and China is integrated into the current global system. China is seeking greater actualization here. I agree with Bonnie and Raja Mohan. Particularly for Asia, China has often repeated the Asian countries should be left alone to solve their own problems and to create their own systems. In that context, Soto Vose, China as Asia's largest economic and military power, would take a leading role. China cites its long history of peaceful development, adherence to principles such as mutual respect for sovereignty and territorial integrity, non-interference in countries' internal affairs, and supporting credentials. And here they've used those credentials to put out their own global security initiative and global development initiative. Now, what was China's reaction to the Ukraine invasion? It's reiterated its fundamental support for sovereignty and territorial integrity. Remember what Wang Yi said in the Munich Security Conference, quote-unquote, uphold the legitimate rights and interests of small and medium-sized countries. Let me end off with risk. The risk of the US and China, two largest economies decoupling, was already there prior to the Russian invasion of Ukraine. A bifurcated global system based on alliances with US or China and Russia will have disastrous consequences on all of us. We are too connected, and such a choice, if it had to be made, will impoverish countries and imperil global security. The US is still the largest economy and global military power, and Singapore believes that it will continue to be. But China is now the largest trading partner of all Asian countries and the EU's largest trading partner in goods at close to 2 billion euros per day. The US-China rivalry is the most significant event. And I'll end off by saying that we are at a pivotal, dangerous inflection in our shared futures. Mm. And I think the challenge for both the US and China leadership is to demonstrate statesmanship, to rise above domestic concerns, to forge a stronger, sustainable, equitable global system. I don't think there's a certainty of that hopeful outcome, but I think our futures and collective well-being depend very much on it.
Oh, thank you. I wanted to come back to your original point, looking at it from the perspective of small states like Singapore. You and many others in the Indo-Pacific region are under constant pressure to pick sides. So you have your dominant economic player in the form of China, and you have your main security actor in the form of the United States. And do you think in an increasingly polarized world that, in a sense, people are saying, to use an old Bushism, you're either for us or you're against us? How does a small state like Singapore thread the eye of the needle?
Well, we're in a happy state of affairs on that account. We have said we don't want to choose sides, and both the US and China says we don't want you to choose sides, so we take everybody. So it's not a problem.
Excellent answer. Natasha.
Let me emphasize that the reason why we said we don't have to and don't need to choose is that we've benefited from the rise, the U.S. is a resident power, and for the last 70 years, Asia has risen economically, in social terms, because of the strategic umbrella provided by the U.S. But China's rise in the last three decades, there is a reason why it's the largest trading partner. And if you remember when Europe and U.S. were in recession, it was the Chinese economic engine that kept Asia growing.
Yeah.
So the question to us is, why do we have to choose, and what are we choosing over?
Yeah. Well, that brings us quite neatly to you, Natasha Kassam, because for Australia, China is the main trading partner, and the United States is the main security partner. But unlike Singapore, you do rather get the impression that Canberra has made a strategic choice. Even during the Trump presidency, it was a kind of a feeling of all the way with LBJ. And so I was wondering whether you could respond to that perhaps unfair criticism.
Well, I should say that it was not that many years ago that a US ambassador allegedly arrived in Canberra and very quickly said, "Who lost Australia?" So I don't think they're saying that anymore. Thanks, Bobo, and thank you to this conference for having me. It's an absolute pleasure to be here. I'm still on Australian time, so if anybody has caught me napping in the back row, I apologise. I mean no disrespect. It's a very long way away. I think to answer that question, we have to think about how we got here. It's really hard to overstate how dramatically Australia's relationship with China has shifted in the last couple of years. Frankly, we still all have whiplash, but you know, in the early 2000s, the gold-tinted lure of China's market just could not be ignored by anyone. And, you know, as the minister has said, China's growth was really driving so much prosperity in Asia. That was also true in Australia. By 2008, China was Australia's largest trading partner. We had very complementary economies, you know, the coal and the iron ore and education and agricultural products that Australia had to sell was exactly what China needed to grow its middle class and to pursue its own development. So you end up in a position where, despite being a, you know, key security ally for the United States, 40% of Australia's exports were going to China. And that continues to be the case today. It's really very dramatic. And you have, by 2014, Australia and China are signing a free trade agreement. They're upgrading their relationship to a comprehensive strategic partnership. Xi Jinping stood in Australian Parliament in 2014 and he said, you know, it is on an ocean of goodwill between our two countries that I am, you know, buoyed by this relationship. It's completely impossible to imagine now. So how is it in just 8 years you go from having this incredibly warm, fruitful relationship between two countries to where we are now, which is no high-level official contact between our countries? We have 14 of Australia's export industries subject to sanctions or tariffs or bans on entering China. We have the Chinese tabloid, the Global Times, on a almost every day, writing these hit pieces about racism in Australia and all the terrible ways in which Australia is the running dog of the United States. And even at the official podium in China's Ministry of Foreign Affairs, pretty regular sprays about all the ways in which Australia has offended China. you know, how has this happened? Part of the story is very much what Bonnie talked about, the way in which China is pursuing its interests. And part of it has been, I think, Australia's willingness, perhaps surprising willingness, to push back on those interests. But I think the key issue here is that for the longest time in Australia, it was a convenient fiction being maintained where everybody believed that we could pursue economic prosperity on one side and we could do security, human rights, all of the other issues on the other. That could be a small part of the relationship that we talked about in the back room, but the majority of the relationship could be this thriving economic one. We've seen those two lanes clash in such a dramatic way, and it's not just Australia. You know, it could happen to anyone. Our Lithuanian friends will tell you that as well. And so what has Australia done in response? I think it's worth just thinking about because it is just such a dramatic shift. We've legislated against foreign interference. We've excluded Huawei and other Chinese companies from our critical infrastructure and 5G rollouts. We've revived the Quad with Japan, India, and the United States. We have formed AUKUS, the security partnership with the United States and the United Kingdom that will see Australia acquire nuclear-powered submarines. What's also remarkable in Australia is just how bipartisan all of these shifts are. They really are very much shared by both sides of the parliament and even by the public. You know, the Australian public, until just 3 years ago, the majority of Australians saw China as an economic partner. They had confidence in Xi Jinping. They trusted China. Now, this has dramatically shifted in just a couple of years. Now, the majority of Australians see China as a security threat. There's very little trust. There's very low levels of confidence. Even in the private sector in Australia, where you might have expected the most pushback, given literally their products are being stopped from entering China. And it is because of China's growth that Australia avoided the global financial crisis, that Australia's had 29 years of uninterrupted economic growth. And even then, you do not hear from the business lobby anymore about the China relationship. You do not have the regular editorials in the Australian newspapers that say, you know, the government is messing up the China relationship. Finally, you know, we're having an election in Australia as I speak. Voting has already opened. Election day is next Saturday. I think it's just another sign of how remarkable this shift in the relationship is and just the role that China is playing in Australian public life. When you think about the fact that we're having an election that is in some ways being fought on national security grounds and both parties are trying incredibly hard to demonstrate just how tough on China they can be. You know, that elections in Australia are not fought on foreign policy traditionally. They're fought on health and education and the economy, just like anywhere else. But this has pervaded Australian public life so much that now China is even an election issue and every punter on the street has a strong opinion on what should happen next.
That's very interesting. I see a couple of levels. So there's the level of Chinese interference in Australian life, harassment of Australian academics, expat activities. But there's also, I get it at that level. What I find perhaps a little bit harder to comprehend is when people throw around terms like rules-based international order as if it were something completely self-explanatory. So the question I always think when people talk about rules-based international order is whose rules, who plays by them, who sets them, and when and where do they apply? And one criticism is that, yes, when the West talks about rules-based international order, they mean Western rules. Now, most of the world is non-West, so what do we understand? Is that a kind of a cynical ploy, a kind of moral fig leaf that, say, Scott Morrison and others use? Or do you think it actually has some applicability in relation to China, Australia, and global order?
Yeah, I think that's a really interesting question. I mean, I'm not sure that the rules-based international order exists anymore to answer one of your questions, at least not in the way that we previously considered it. And maybe on some level that's appropriate, as you say. So much of the world was not involved in designing those rules. And, you know, if we truly want, in Australian terms, we want a region that's free and open and where countries live without fear of coercion, I mean, that should include coercion from Western countries, right? Yep. So I think on some level, you know, there is a bit of cynicism from my perspective. But I would also say that most countries, certainly not all countries, but most countries that participate in the international system and abide by the rules, generally find that they work for them.
Okay.
And they, I think, want to uphold at least levels of them. And, you know, in, from my perspective, it's not necessarily about looking at things in terms of, you know, democracies versus autocracies.
Mm-hmm.
What are the principles that work for most countries? Transparency, accountability,
mm-hmm.
you know, getting rid of corruption. These are things that I think, regardless of your political system, most people see as being beneficial to their economy and to their
okay.
people. But I think that also includes China. You know, I mean, I know mm-hmm. we'll get into this mm-hmm. later, but as China looks to reform elements of the international system, I think it really does selectively engage. It
yeah.
ignores some elements of the system,
sure.
it avoids some elements of the system, and it looks to completely overturn and shift some parts of the system. But it isn't, you know, it isn't about tipping the table over from my perspective.
Right.
Elements of the international system, I'm thinking particularly of trade, and we mentioned the WTO, have worked very well for China. And if you look at, for example, in 2019, when the WTO's appellate body stopped functioning because of the United States appointing judges, it was China, Australia, the European Union who came together to negotiate an alternative
yeah.
agreement, right? So in some cases, it does work for China.
I mean, there is an argument that all great powers adopt a la carte approach to the rules-based international order. But look, I'm going to come to Rajamohan and then to Bonnie. So, Raj.
There is a problem in this macro-level argument, whose rules, what rules. I mean, I'll tell you two types of rules. For 30 years, since Rajiv Gandhi went to Deng Xiaoping, we negotiated a whole series of bilateral agreements on how to keep peace and stability on the border. 30 years.
Yeah.
I mean, very macro level. The main element was neither side will bring large number of troops close to the disputed border.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, this in 2020 spring, Chinese bring in 60,000 troops
yes.
to India's border.
Indeed, indeed.
Now, these rules were not imposed by the Americans.
Exactly.
These rules we negotiated bilaterally.
Yeah.
And you say, look,
yeah.
I'm bigger power now. And these are anyway my territory. So I'm just taking what's mine. Just as Putin says, yeah, Ukraine, no sovereignty. It actually belongs to me. So I'm taking it.
Mm.
So it is the problem is not whose rules. The problem is how do you think of your own power and what you're trying to do with
yeah.
it? Second,
yeah.
UNCLOS
you
take.
Point.
Okay, Americans are not part of UNCLOS. That's always a standard argument.
Mm-hmm.
But the Permanent Court of Arbitration, when Philippines went to the Permanent Court of Arbitration with a number of issues of how you think about South China Sea, Chinese said, oh, we don't even think PCA has a jurisdiction on this.
Yep. Yep.
I have historic rights, and I'm just taking my historic rights.
Mm.
And the court ruled on every one of the disputes,
yes.
you know, unanimously in favor of the Philippines. But Chinese said, no, sorry, it doesn't apply. And finally,
yeah.
Natuna is an island close to Indonesia, maybe 2,000 odd kilometers away from Chinese mainland. But Chinese say, I have a right, fishing rights in Natuna, so I'll come and take it. So I think this is what is the problem, not the abstract theoretical definition of what are the rules based on. China is powerful today, and it thinks it can use that power for national benefit unilaterally, which is the problem for China's neighbors.
Yep, yep. Points well made. Bonnie.
Let me build on the points you have made, Raja. I was also going to mention the Convention on the Law of the Sea. We have to remember that, in fact, China was part of the negotiations for UNCLOS. It was in on the ground floor. And the United States, of course, at the time was in the negotiations. The other countries, we won some points. China won some points. But now, today, here we are, the United States is not a signatory to UNCLOS, but we abide by all of the convention as customary law. China, on the other hand, is a signatory and does not abide by UNCLOS. But it seems to me to be a bit false that the Chinese say that the rules were in every case made by others, because at least that's one example where the Chinese very much shaped the rules. Just one other point I wanted to come back on, just to maybe give the group here a bit of a different perspective, is on one of your other points, Raja. I don't think it's all about Xi Jinping. China did not begin to become assertive when Xi Jinping came to power in 2012, when he became the general secretary of the party. And of course, we can look at the beginning of real trade coercion against Norway in 2010, against Japan in 2010 with the rare earths episode. You can look at the beginnings of the South China Sea, and it was my Secretary of State at the time, Hillary Clinton, in 2011, that was present at the ASEAN Regional Forum meeting, where Yang Jiechi was quoted as saying, I believe pointing to the Singaporean minister at the time, you are all small That's countries, right?
Forget it.
And we are a big country. Yeah. You have to respect us. But I think importantly, if you look at the internal documents in China, you will find that with the onset of the global financial crisis, this was the real beginning, the assessment of the United States in decline. And I go back to what I said earlier, that factor of how China assesses the power gap between the U.S. and China has really shaped Chinese foreign policy. And so as that power gap has narrowed, the Chinese have become more ambitious. They, like the Russians, have a sense of grievance, of victimization. And every Chinese leader, of course, has had as a goal national rejuvenation. The entire Chinese people want this. And their interests, they believe, should come before the interests of others. Mm. So every country that has challenged Chinese interests and put their own interests before China's, just look at South Korea as it deployed the THAAD missile defense system to defend against North Korean missiles, and they got punished. And our newly elected South Korean president, I hope, but perhaps might in fact face similar steps and actions from China. So I don't think this is all about, now Xi Jinping is a factor, but I'm just not convinced.
Xi Jinping was the vice president under Hu Jintao, right? He was the Politburo, you know.
The party. Yeah. Elected, the party wanted Xi Jinping there because Hu Jintao had been too weak a leader.
Yeah.
They wanted firmer party control over the military and over the system. And that's what they got. It probably got even more than they bargained for.
Okay. You raised a couple of interesting points. I mean, one is that one of the crowning ironies of this is that China has been the single greatest beneficiary of the liberal international order, I would say, over the last three decades, more so than even any Western democracy. But the other thing is, there's a lot of people talk about Chinese having, you know, a 100-year vision, but episodes like the global financial crisis make me think that the Chinese, as much as any policymakers in the world, make policy on the hoof. They improvise. They might have a general wish that they want to be play a global leadership role, but fundamentally, they'll just see how the cards play out. And in this case, the global financial crisis, they identified an opportunity. They saw the fallibility of the West, and they thought, we'll go for it. But Defense Minister, please, to you.
Bobo, I owe you an answer about autocracies and liberal democracies. And
yes.
I wanted to pull that together, some of the threats that were my other accomplished panelists have brought up. And it addresses the question, how do you, as we've been discussing, how do you treat China? Do you treat it like USSR? Do you precipitate a Cold War? Is that into our interests? Do you treat it like Russia? Do you isolate it? Can you afford to do it? Do you treat it as an ideological competitor, that if you don't fulfill a set of values, then I can't trade with you, then I can't develop the world with you? What is the alternative? And framing the consequences of the Ukraine invasion as widening its remit, as now addressing the issue of liberal democracies and autocracies, in our view, immediately puts China in the wrong camp. Because by any stretch, this, apart from its economic prowess and number of billionaires, very few people will put China under the liberal democracy camp. And once you frame it that way, it must mean not only competition, but increasing isolation. And in our view, that's not a productive aspect. But let's get back to the key question. How do you deal with China? I would say that globalization, as you rightly pointed out, has been very beneficial to China as well as to many countries. All of us are countries. There is a reason why, in terms of the EU, China is your largest trading partner. You didn't do it for altruistic reasons, I presume. Similarly for Asia. Similarly for India, if you could, too. And it cannot be a debate about whether you're pure enough. Raja Mohan mentioned the indiscretions of the Chinese government and various points. If you were to draw up a list of misdemeanors and mistakes by hegemons, there will be no end of arguments. Some are less pure than others, and that's as much as we can conclude. So Singapore's view is having benefited from both resident power and a rising power that you will need both. Yeah. And you cannot treat China as you would Russia or USSR. Yeah. Now, that gives a view. That doesn't give you a strategy.
But it's a start.
It's a start. Yeah. It may be the correct start, and we believe a firmer start. Then the issue is in the absence of trade. And if you are moving towards a bifurcated system based on technology, based on supply lines, based on diplomatic relations, where does it end up? If it's just frame that you can't have economic engagement with China because you don't think it's pure enough, or you don't think that it's contributing to the world order, or and then you just limit it to cultural exchanges, then I think our State Departments won't have much work to do.
Yeah.
We think that the decider of this relationship is the U.S. and Chinese leadership. And I'll remind members here that when there was when Nixon and Kissinger approached Mao for the detente, it was almost the worst of times, probably worse than now. Is it too much to expect that for our collective good, that some form of rapprochement, some form of common ground that benefits US, that benefits EU, that benefits China, can be found, that benefits India? There must be economic opportunities to be gotten from China with its rising middle class, with its wealth. As any Chinaman will tell you, with roots and DNA of China, Chinamen understand commerce.
Okay, great. I'm going to open it out to the floor. So the way we're going to do this, I propose, is we'll take it in sets of five. But for that to work, you need to do two things. One is state your name. And the other, please restrict yourselves to one-point interventions or one-point questions. Edward Lucas.
Edward Lucas from SEPA. If we'd been having this panel, say, 2 years ago, the words wolf warrior diplomacy would have come up a lot. And I wondered if anyone on the panel would like to comment on what seems to be a move away from this very combative approach, which was particularly visible in embassies here in this part of the world, such as in Sweden, picking unnecessary fights and getting involved in things like book publishing decisions, attacking specific journalists, all sorts of other what could be seen as attempts by the Chinese Communist Party to control the way political and media freedoms are exercised in Western societies. Is this just a pause? Is the ambition still there, but the tactic has changed, or did the perpetrators of wolf warrior diplomacy realize that it was counterproductive and they should just try something else?
Edward, lady behind you.
Hello, I'm Sigita Struberga, Latvian Transatlantic Organization. So I have a question regarding Russian-Chinese relations. So right before the war, we faced this announcement about borderless relations and support between Russia and China. At the same time, it was already mentioned that there are still borders when it comes to economic interests of China. And also we know that Russia was careful enough regarding relations with China, understanding that China is not seeing Russia as the same level partner. China is rather seeing Russia as a youngest brother, smallest brother. So my question is, in this context, which we have now, will Russia agree to be the youngest brother of China? Excellent. Will Putin agree to be in this position? And the second question is...
We have to do it this way. Okay. Gentleman right at the back there. Yes, over. Yep, over there.
Thank you. My name is Karel Kullama. I'm the junior research fellow here at Estonian Foreign Policy Institute at ICDS. And my question goes to Mr. Mohan. And when we were looking here in the Kashmir conflict, from the Estonian perspective, it was really easy to relate to what it feels like to live beside the expansionist communist regime. What was not so easy to understand, why did India decide to participate in Sabha 2021 in the military exercise with its troops?
Mark Lantain, just over here in the front here, sorry.
Thank you very much. Mark Lantain, University of Tromsø. So many questions, but we're coming up on the 10th anniversary of the Belt and Road. And if you look at China's economic situation right now, especially in regards to the global economy, we're seeing two different solitudes, if you will. The BRI is still growing, albeit in fits and starts. You look at Africa, Oceania, Latin America. But on the other hand, we are seeing some very significant issues related to isolationism due to zero COVID. As was mentioned, we're starting to see geoeconomics at work, wolf warrior diplomacy. Critics are arguing that what China is trying to do is to drive a car with one foot on the brake and one foot on the accelerator. So my question is the car going to break down? Thank you.
And gentlemen, just in the front here.
Thanks, Kosh Arho. I always admired...
Your name, sorry.
Kosh Arho.
All right, yeah.
Admired the Singaporean view, had good discussion with Bihari Kaushikan on a third way, the Singaporean way, and I appreciate Singapore's strong position on the Ukraine. I'd like to see if I can ask you to thread the needle and reconcile your position on Ukraine, sorry, not Kaushikan, and with China. On one side, you're standing for rule-based order. On the other side, we have this notion, the discussion here, eerily reminiscent. If we were in this city or this part of the world 10 years ago talking about Russia, there were some people who were saying, look, they've done this in Kazakhstan, they've done this in Kyrgyz, they've done it in Georgia, they're going to do it in Crimea, they'll continue to do so. Other people said, nobody's pure, we can't really have a purity test. You know, we gotta live with them. Nobody can wish them away. Not entirely sure who's wishing who away, but this keeps coming up. Nobody can wish anybody away. But we'll work it out. So you've taken a pretty strong view on Ukraine, God bless you. But on this issue, when Rajamohan goes up with a litany of engagement, which are pretty substantial territorial, they go a little bit beyond just a purity test. And I think it affects you whether you are yourself invaded or is far away to say, we have benefited from the trade, how do we do it? So maybe I'm missing the point, but it'd be great to see that it's not reminiscent we talk about in 10, 20 years and say that was a mistake.
Okay, great. Thank you. Natasha, do you want to start responses? Just pick whichever one.
Sure, it's a lot of questions. I'll answer a couple. I think the question about wolf warrior diplomacy and whether that is gone, I actually think we've just internalized and normalized it on some level, and it's across the entire system. For example, if you look at the way in which Chinese spokespeople have been talking about the war in Ukraine, They point to NATO expansionism. They point to the follies of the United States. They say, when you put a big country up against a wall, what do you expect them to do? All of this, to me, is very similar messaging to what we saw under Wolf Warrior diplomacy, but now it is pervasive through the whole system. The other thing that was always interesting from the Wolf Warrior point of view is the way in which messages were very much moderated depending on different audiences. So if you're in Australia, you still hear a lot of Wolf Warrior language, for example. But also when you think about the different messages that have been taken on Ukraine, you know, when Chinese foreign minister is at Munich, he's saying something quite different to what he's saying domestically. And we're seeing that, I think, continue. So I think maybe we've just gotten a little too used to what we might call Wolf Warrior diplomacy rather than that moving away. Others might have a different view. The other question was about Putin being, or Russia being, the junior partner to China. I think that, you know, people prior to the February announcement of the joint partnership and the friendship with no limits between Russia and China, people very much thought that Russia would not be comfortable being the junior partner. I think that, in my view, it's clear that Russia is comfortable in that role now. You look at that statement and you see that they've fully adopted, for example, all of China's language on Taiwan. But the statement does not include all of Russia's language on Ukraine. Just as one example, you can see China is setting some of the terms. Some of the deal around the pipeline was very much according to the terms under which China dictated. Then I think you look at the way this relationship has played out, and yes, I agree with Bonnie that China has very much doubled down on backing Russia in as much as it can, but it's certainly not as much as Russia might have hoped for from China. And again, I think that they will take what they can get in that relationship. I don't think that Russia would have expected China to expose itself to sanctions, for example. So I'm not sure that there is a mismatch of expectations there. But still, I do think that China is the larger partner. Russia is comfortable with that and I think would rather have China on its side than not. The only other question I was just going to mention was the BRI and the kind of geoeconomic strategy. And yeah, we have seen that in stops and starts, but I think that China's diplomats overseas, particularly in developing countries, are still working very hard, even as the country is shut down. You know, I'm in Australia, we've just had a security agreement negotiated with the Solomon Islands next door. That managed to happen even while China is kind of going through this shutdown. And so, you know, there are lots of other dynamics going on there. And I think the trade issues that will come out of a lot of China being closed and the idea they're now pursuing zero COVID even into next year, it seems, with the cancellation of the Asian Games. So that is going to throw up other questions, but I still think that China has very skillful diplomats, particularly in the global south, and they're continuing to work very hard on some of these projects. Same with the big Chinese SOEs and others that are involved in implementing the BRI projects overseas.
Great.
Well, just a quick response to that question. How does Singapore square its position in terms of vote on Ukraine and its actions in Ukraine and viewing China as, and the gentleman mentioned how this was reminiscent of the arguments against China. Our position is entirely consistent. And we voted against territorial invasion of Ukraine. And we've done it before. We did so when Vietnam occupied Cambodia. We would do it so again if that principle was transgressed. Now, the question that needs to be squared is perhaps not, or we leave each country to decide its own position, but I'll remind you of India's position and voting in the UN.
Okay. Roger.
Okay, I mean, I wanted to say something on the China-Sino-Russian relationship. I think one of the great things Ukraine has done is to force I think there will be serious reconsideration. On February 4th, it looked like the world had seen a dramatic moment, China and Russia coming together for a relationship without, no areas, prohibited areas, and no limits. But I think by prolonging this war and have exposed not only the Russian weakness, is my view, I mean, they've also probably there are a couple of guys in the Politburo who say, look, was it a correct decision to have backed Putin so fully? But the problem is the emperor cannot say he made a mistake, either based on zero COVID, exactly, or on backing Russia on a misadventure. So my sense is, by winning this war or by preventing Russia from winning Ukraine, I think it's going to trigger a whole series of developments. What seemed a clear joint anti-Western front. Because after all, Putin had a choice to go with the West. June 2021, Biden met Putin in Geneva, exploring the options for a predictable relationship. But Putin made a choice, and Xi Jinping made a choice. But I think the choice has been complicated by what's happening on the ground, and I think that's for the future to say. Second, I think on the India-China military exercises, look, we have to live with the Chinese. Look, I mean, for everybody else can take any kind of positions. I mean, we have a serious dispute
with China.
Not only
you.
We say our boundary is 4,000 kilometers. And the Chinese say, no, no, it's only 2,000. Like, it tells you the scale of the dispute. We don't even agree on where we are on the boundary. So we don't even say this is the line. We say line of actual control. So we don't agree on where the line of actual control is. So we are living with that ambiguity. So if any option to engage them at any level, we continue to do it. But we've also taken steps after what happened last 2020. We've kept our Huawei. We've limiting the restricting the Chinese investments into India. We have moved to the Quad. If anybody has not noticed, this is going to be the third summit in 15 months next this week in Tokyo. So India is making its balancing. That doesn't mean I don't talk to the Chinese.
Yeah, indeed.
So I have to deal with them. And my sense is, this is where the question of how you deal with China is not by framing in autocracy, but if he's violating the neighbor's boundary, we need to push back.
Yeah, exactly.
We need to deter Chinese expansionism. Yeah. We need to challenge the Chinese weaponizing trade and other issues. So these are nothing to do with the nature of the regime internally. And that, I think if we do that right, that itself, I think, could produce changes in the regime internally. So let's focus on what the problems are, rather than this ideological debate about democracies versus autocracies, which is not going to get us anywhere. And I remember, I'll remind some of my American friends, there's something called Jean Kirkpatrick doctrine, that authoritarians, if they support America, they were good.
That's right. Yes.
So we've seen a lot change. So I think
I've not heard of that.
Yeah, maybe it's the 1980s. When Carter said, look, we promote democracy, Reagan said, no, who supported the Afghan jihad? It was our American friends. So I think these things have changed because there was an attempt to deal with Soviet Union. Certain strategies were adopted. I'm not criticizing anyone. So don't frame these in those terms. Yeah. I mean, the Chinese expansionist policies are a problem, irrespective of the nature of the regime, and we're going to deal with it. Yeah. And similarly, if there is a Belt and Road Initiative, are we giving alternatives? I think that is the question.
Yeah.
For the first time, Europe, I think, is putting real money on the table. How much? 300 billion euros or $300 billion. It's welcome. Because I keep reminding my friends, for all the talk about Chinese, we kind of cede so much to credibility to the Chinese by debating on their terms. China hasn't built a single Suez Canal so far. Well, it is the Europeans, the French and the British who built it. So that given the scale of the historic infrastructure projects, I think it's easy to overrate Belt and Road. And if the Europeans and the Americans and the Japanese can put real money, offer an alternative on interest rates, on repayment terms, people will take it. So I think finally the act is coming together. So I think that is the real question, not again debating the thing in ideological terms.
Roger, just a quick one. I think one of your erstwhile colleagues, Evan Feigenbaum, put it very well in terms of competing with China. Whining isn't competing. You actually have to do better. You can't just criticize and say, please don't do that. You actually need to provide a more constructive alternative. Bonnie.
On the question of whether Putin will agree to be sort of the junior partner, I will respond to this from the perspective of a China expert. I'm not a Russia expert, but I can say that the Chinese, particularly Xi Jinping, does not treat Putin as a junior partner. He treats him with great respect.
Exactly.
They have met 38 times. Yeah. And at various junctures, Xi Jinping has consulted with Putin. So even though the Chinese very clearly view Russia as in decline, they nevertheless treat Putin with great respect. And I think that really matters. And there are issues where they disagree, but Xi Jinping then agrees to compartmentalize and not even raise issues. You know, I recall Putin once stated that Xi Jinping has never mentioned the South China Sea in a conversation with him, even though the Russians are invested in blocks off the coast of Vietnam. So there are, even in Central Asia, where they have obviously some competition, but the Chinese have allowed the Russians to play the primary security role while China plays an ever greater economic role. Yeah. So I think that Xi Jinping has actually handled this relationship very well.
Yeah.
Russia's dependence on China will grow. Yeah. This would have happened regardless of the war. So it will be interesting to see whether this continues in the future. I really do just want to agree with what Natasha said about Wolf Warrior diplomacy. It is still quite present. The anti-American rhetoric coming out of China in the state-controlled media is honestly the worst I have ever seen. Vitriol in the People's Daily and the People's Liberation Army Daily. So it perhaps we have just normalized this. Where I've seen some change is individual ambassadors. And our friends, of course, in Sweden and Australia know they have new ambassadors who've decided to try some new approaches. And I don't know whether that's an overall change of the foreign ministry or individuals as they come into their own roles. We have a relatively new ambassador in Washington, D.C., and his predecessor was not a wolf warrior, but the new guy, Qin Gang. I think he's trying out different personalities and different approaches, so sometimes he does appear a bit wolf warrior. Finally, I just want to make a point on this discussion about autocracy versus democracy. There's such an interesting range of views on the panel. My own view is that when it comes to our relationships in the Indo-Pacific region and the goal that I talked about earlier of working with allies and partners and shaping the strategic environment around China, if we use this frame of autocracy versus democracies, we are losing out potentially on the opportunity to have some very important countries work alongside us to shape China's choices. One is Singapore. And
what are we wanting?
I would say neither, and that's the problem with putting countries in baskets.
Let's not go there.
Let's not go there. There are some people that are uncomfortable today. I'm not going to take this view, but there are people who are uncomfortable calling India a democracy. And Vietnam, of course. There's no question.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
So I don't think that it serves our interest to use this frame, but my president has done so.
Yep. Can I just make three very quick points on Sino-Russian partnership before we do the second round? I think that the protracted war in Ukraine has highlighted the limits of the no-limits partnership between China and Russia. I think what the Chinese have done is be very vocal in their rhetorical support for Russia while doing the absolute bare minimum in terms of substantive material support. So essentially threading, preserving the Sino-Russian partnership with avoiding sanctions from the West. I also fundamentally disagree with this idea of an alliance of autocracies because I see China and Russia having very different views of global order. The Chinese believe in a global order, one where its influence is vastly greater than it is today, where Western influence is much, much reduced, but nevertheless, they believe in an order. The Russians do not. They believe in a disorder. And I think that is perhaps the most fundamental difference that you can have in international relations today. Now, next round, I will go for, we're going to take a whole bunch. You first. Then I'll come to you.
Thank you very much, Boris Ruger, Munich Security Conference. Question to Bonnie, Taiwan. What has Taiwan learned from this Russian war against Ukraine? And how is the US adjusting, if it is adjusting, its attitude towards Taiwan's strategic ambiguity, or more than strategic ambiguity, and perhaps Japan as well?
Okay, just pass the microphone there.
Katja Gerschak, Center for European Perspective in Slovenia. The question of, and I'll put this very simply, territorial expansion versus influence. And maybe just what Bobo was saying, is there an opportunity if we are discussing some sort of a global order where the Chinese do have a bigger influence, would they still have the ambition of such territorial expansion? Do these always go hand in hand, or do you believe they don't?
Charles Grant.
Dare I mention the word Europe? I have a question for Bonnie. The question is Europe's ability to work with the US on China. President Biden, unlike his predecessor, has tried quite hard to get them some cooperation, which is great. But my point is this: the fundamental approach of the two is rather different. The Europeans, I think, are bothered by Chinese behavior, abusing human rights, cheating on intellectual property, and so on. They're not so bothered by Chinese power per se, while the Americans are bothered by Chinese power and would still see China as a threat even if China behaved better. So given that fundamental difference of approach, can they work together in the long run on dealing with China?
Charles, can you pass the mic to James Scher, please?
Thanks, Charles. Raja Mohan answered half my question, but I want to accentuate the significance of this moment. In Bonnie's presentation, she had mentioned that it has been the gap between China and US power that has tended to define the art of the possible in China. Now what we see is the breathtaking scale of Russia's recklessness, its misjudgments, the incompetence of its military, its failures, has deeply unsettled China, its calculations, has, as I think you were suggesting also, strengthened its instincts for prudence, and not incidentally completely discredited those in the United States who are arguing that we should park Russia and focus on China and try to woo Russia away from China, because quite the opposite has happened. China is redoing all of its sums. So you would the panel agree with that analysis?
Okay, and gentlemen there.
Yes, thank you. Juri Seelentel, Estonian Foreign Ministry, and dealing with trade mostly, but I have a wider question. I was a bit surprised, and I hope I misunderstood the panel, on the rules-based international order, because the vibe I was getting was that somehow it seems to be almost acceptable to say that now we don't follow it anymore. And I think it's a mistake to say that some countries who were not present when it was agreed, we can let it go, because frankly, Estonia wasn't present as well. We were founding member of League of Nations, but when, for example, what is rule-based international order, UN Charter, Universal Declaration on Human Rights, even WTO, we were 5 minutes late, but we signed up. So I wouldn't give up on that.
Okay.
And the other thing I derive from that is that the rules-based international order is like a brick wall. You can take out a piece, another one, it becomes weaker and weaker.
Yeah,
and
I think
the Chinese actually understand it, and they can take more risk. But we still should be of the position that it's not a good idea to choose and pick necessary pieces, but it's a whole. Thank you.
All right. Now, before I come back to you, I want to bring in a Japanese perspective, if I may, from Koichiro Matsumoto here, just here.
Thank you very much. I'm Koichiro Matsumoto. I'm from the Japanese Prime Minister's office. I really enjoyed your discussion. Thank you very much. My question is about Indo-Pacific, free and open Indo-Pacific, and Quad. I think Dr. Mohan has already mentioned this before, but I think Indo-Pacific deserves a prevalence of rule-based order, because that accommodates the global engine of growth. We have China, India, Japan, South Korea, Taiwan, Australia, and of course, the United States as well. In order to achieve this, we came with this idea that we need some flag bearers of a rule-based order. To our minds, Quad, that is Japan, United States, India, and Australia, serve as a group of countries in this regard. Now, as Professor Mohan has mentioned, we are only 1 week away before the Quad Summit to take place in Tokyo. And we have, you know, a lot of, you know, working groups in place, and they have produced a lot of wonderful results. But at the same time, we have to admit this, but China has always, I mean, been one of the hidden agendas, to say the least. According to the military balance, 40% of the Asia's military spending was that of China. Well, Japan was 10%, South Korea more or less the same. So against this backdrop, my question goes to all of you, well, especially those who are coming from the Quad countries. What would be your expectations in the next Quad Leaders Summit in Tokyo? And to Your Excellency, Minister Ng, I would like to know how is Quad viewed in Asian countries, Southeast Asian countries, inter alia Singapore? Thank you.
Natasha, do you want to kick off on the Quad?
Absolutely. So the Quad meeting in Tokyo, I think, is 4 days after our election. So it's unclear exactly who will be attending from the Australian side, but both leaders have committed to attending if we have a result by then. I'll just say that I think that my expectations, or I would say in Australia, the expectations are to see more in terms of supply chains resilience, critical infrastructure cooperation. And I think that one of the really important things is the development side of the Quad, which has been talked about, and there was the vaccine initiative, but hasn't necessarily happened yet. The hidden agenda of the Quad being China is not that hidden, but I think that one of the things that Quad countries can offer in our region is more of a positive vision, more of an alternative, like what Raja was saying. And so things like vaccines, things like infrastructure, and actually working together to provide things rather than working together just to contain China, I think is what we would be looking for.
Before I come back to you, Minister, I'll go, because we're on this sort of Quad thread, and Raja, you've got a number of questions. You don't have to answer them all, but
no, but I think
I will come back to the minister.
ASEAN had a very
No.
There was an ASEAN.
No one will be left
Biden
behind.
Summit just a few days ago. I wanted to just deal with one or two questions. I mean, I think one on the European question. I think what we've seen, you know, thanks to the Sino-Russian collaboration, this idea of thinking Europe and Asia as two different theaters, completely and that unconnected, that is, I think, beginning to change, yeah, thanks to the Sino-Russian. And the fact that how does the US handle both the theaters? Many people said, look, can't walk and chew gum in both the places. US has shown, actually, that it can simultaneously take on both Russia and China. Mm. And I think that's quite a difference. And I think because of the failure of the Ukraine military intervention, it's already induced some restraint on China, and I think there will be more consequences down the road. On the economic side, I mean, just as the Wall Street loves China, the Bavarian car companies love China. The whole sense of the Europeans, while they talk about norms, look, there's been a very deep, especially in Germany, the deep economic connection to the Chinese market. The question is now, those who are taking very strong, very firm positions against Russia in Europe, are they prepared to take the same positions in relation to China, China's territorial expansion in Asia? I mean, I would like to see that. Yeah. And also would like to see if they're actually willing to take some haircut on their economic investments in China, if it is all about rules-based order, yeah, if it is about actually dealing with aggression. My sense is the Americans are putting pressure, and I think that's a good thing. From Indian perspective, I would say, with the Russian and the Chinese markets put under cloud, I hope India can open up and give more opportunities for the European companies to come and invest. We have a large market as well, and I think that's work in progress. Hopefully, something will happen on that front. So, the Europeans, I think they need to take a fresh look at Asia, whether you call it Indo-Pacific, whatever it is, doesn't matter. That I think you need to pay a lot more attention. But if Europe can take care of its own security,
yeah,
that is not just totally dependent on the Americans. I think the U.S. can play a larger role in the Indo-Pacific. So I think that's where a Europe that doesn't only rely on the United States to deal with the Russian challenge actually liberates America to do more in Asia. And I think that's very welcome for us.
Yeah, great. I'll go to the minister in a moment. Bonnie first.
Just on the Quad or a few questions?
Well, just pick a couple, I think.
Okay,
just
I'll pick a couple.
Because I want to just squeeze in a couple
okay,
more people.
Okay, I will. I
it's difficult, I know. But
some very good questions I'd like to answer. On the Quad, I think it's really important that the focus does remain on provision of public goods for the region. But it is, of course, not true to say that there is no security component to the Quad. I think we will see that grow a bit in this upcoming meeting. I understand there will be a new maritime initiative, and I'm looking forward to hearing about that. But this is a very important set of cooperation between, of course, all four countries. And I think that we will also see more cooperation between the Quad and non-Quad members and some of the working groups. And South Korea will, of course, be one of them. Charles's question, I think I have a little bit of a different perspective. I don't think that the United States simply objects to Chinese power, that regardless of what they do with it, we would oppose the amassing of Chinese power. You can go back to 2005 in the Bob Zelik responsible stakeholder speech, or the stance of the Obama administration when they first came into power, essentially telling the Chinese, we hope you will use your growing power to contribute to stability in the region, to bolstering the international order. So I think that the question is how China uses its power to advance its interests. And I think it's the choices that the Chinese have made that have led to this, this tension. But your question is a good one on the transatlantic relationship and where our differences are. And there's no doubt there are some areas where there's a lot of overlap, like human rights. And then there are other areas where there are differences. But one area that I would highlight that we should pay attention to going forward, which is a real priority of the Biden administration, is technology.
Yeah.
Xi Jinping has recognized long ago that technology is crucially important for China to achieve its national rejuvenation, including the targets that he set out for in 2035. And so I think you'll see increasingly U.S. efforts to slow down China's development of strategically important technologies. And so this includes the development of new tools to do so, but it also, and one example would be overseas investment screening. And this is something we're gonna have to work on with our European allies. On Boris's question about Taiwan, and you talked about this a little bit last night in the session, which was terrific. You know, Taiwan is still learning lessons, but I think we have to break down the different interest group and parts of the Taiwan system. At the highest level, there is no doubt that Tsai Ing-wen, the president, understands what needs to be learned from the war in Ukraine for Taiwan. And we see evidence that the people in Taiwan want to learn that where they can go to get a rifle to shoot, maybe some military medicine capabilities, trauma surgery. There's a lot of evidence that of growing willingness of the average public to have the ways to defend themselves. But the problem is in the military. And the Taiwanese military, I think, essentially wants to stop the PLA from landing on the beach, and I think is less interested in working with the civilians to build the kind of territorial defense force like they have in Finland and so many of the Baltic states. This, in my view, needs to change. So I'll turn it back.
No, that's a fascinating answer, Minister.
Well, quick answer to. The question, what do ASEAN states, how do they view Quad, and I would throw AUKUS together with that. ASEAN hasn't given a uniform view, so I can't speak on behalf of ASEAN, but from Singapore's perspective, we recognize the right. In fact, it's what governments do to form strategic alliances that work for their own benefit. And the Quad will fall into this, and including the AUKUS. We have our own, for Singapore's context, we have the five-power defense arrangement that began more than 50 years ago after the British pulled out of Southeast Asia, we have the ASEAN Defense Ministers meeting, which is the 10 plus 8, 10 ASEAN countries and 8 extra ASEAN countries. And we have inscribed in it the values in terms of it to be inclusive and non-threatening. We would remind whatever security constructs that countries have agreed, have signed on for the zone of friendship and neutrality at ASEAN and the Treaty of Amity and Cooperation. And in that context, for security alliances not to be directed at any one country, and which Quad and AUKUS have said it is not. Is there a risk that these security alliances can be focused on anti-China, and that will push not only in security terms, but economic terms to what I said would be a danger in terms of a bifurcated system? I think theoretically, yes. But as it is, I think these are decisions that leaders in various countries have done, and we'll have to see how they progress.
Thank you, Minister. We're pretty much out of time, but we started slightly late, so I will take a couple of final questions, if you have any. Otherwise, any from women, by the way. There's been slightly male-dominated here. Okay, sir. Anyone else? Yes. Okay.
Vykintas Pugačiauskas, foreign editor with public television in Lithuania, one country that no longer has a Chinese ambassador at all, or the Chinese embassy at all. My question, though, is about personalities. I take the point that Xi Jinping is not everything, and that there's life after Xi Jinping. But basically, the question is, what if the blunders during his third term will be too big? Hand management of the economy, wrong assumptions about Taiwan, and things like that. Will there be life after Xi Jinping?
It's not on.
Sorry. Speak. It's still not on.
It's this side.
Yeah,
now it's on. Right. Thank God it didn't go through, because I told my old job. So, Pierre Kuzik, Minister of Foreign Affairs of Estonia. I wanted to ask, it was mentioned that China is learning about what the sanctions are about right now. What do you think are the conclusions, and will the West have anything left to influence China after they finish their study? Thank you.
And the last question is mine. Europeans like to advise the rest of the world. What is the single piece of advice that you would give to European policymakers about how to deal and engage with China?
Who started?
Bonnie, why don't you go?
So several questions. I'll just make some brief points. Regarding your question, what lessons is China learning on this, the US learning on the sanctions, China learning? I think we are all trying in the West to develop new tools, and I think Europe is also. You're looking at like the anti-economic coercion instrument here in the EU. We have developed and are finding new ways to apply the foreign direct product rule. So there will be things left. There are new creative export controls that are being considered. And so I think that the US will continue to develop ways, EU will, but the Chinese are going, they've now started implementing their own sanctions legislation, but we really have yet to see how they will apply them. But I think we will see that going forward. I don't know if I really should give advice to Europe on how to deal with China. But I'd like to just make a general point, which I think is builds on something you said earlier, Raja, that we really should not think of the Indo-Pacific theater and the European theater as completely separate.
Yeah.
And Biden administration officials are beginning to think of this now more as one theater, that what happens in one will affect the other.
Yes.
And so We hope that even as Europe remains focused, of course, first and foremost on the war in Ukraine, that it keeps its eye on the Indo-Pacific theater, that it continues to be involved. For us in the United States, as Celeste Wallander said yesterday, we absolutely must be in both theaters, and we should think of them more as connected in the future, and I hope that Europe will do that.
Okay, Roger.
Listen, Europe, you take care of yourself. It'll make it easier for us to deal with Russia. So if you deal with the Russia question well, create European defense structures, I think you can play a larger role in Asia as well. Implement the Global Gateway Project. And three, begin to take a fresh look at China. I'm not saying abandon your trade at this point, but start thinking how you deal with China and deal with abandon Asia, China first strategy in Asia. If you deal with more with Japan, I think is already beginning to happen with India, with Australia, other countries, your options in Asia will also open up.
Okay. Natasha.
So very quickly, I think I didn't answer the question earlier about the rules-based order, where I was being a little bit facetious by saying the way that it, you know, has existed, I don't think it does anymore. Much of it has, I think, eroded, but not everything, and it's absolutely worth fighting for the rules and institutions that we have. What I mean, though, is, for example, the Human Rights Council no longer functions as it used to, and I'm not sure that we can rescue that because of the influence of countries like China and others. On what China is learning from sanctions, I think it's been covered, but I would just say that China's dual circulation policy, which looks to boost domestic consumption and reduce its reliance on the world, I think is going to be hastened by what they've seen happen to Russia. In essence, China is looking to reduce their reliance on any other country while increasing the reliance of the rest of the world on them, and they think that would insulate them from sanctions in the future, or looking at using different central bank currencies, for example, to avoid SWIFT. I think there's lots of things that they can still do. I also am not in a good position to give Europe advice, but I will say Bonnie mentioned that her president used the democracy autocracy framing. My prime minister used the arc of autocracy framing. You know, in Europe, I think it makes sense when you think about these contests to be between democracy and autocracy. But in our part of the world, it really doesn't. And I would encourage Europe and anybody else looking at the Indo-Pacific to think about being inclusive, because we need most of the region to be a part of this system. We need people to be on board. You look at the region we're in, and most countries are not participating in sanctions against Russia. Most countries are not loudly condemning Russia's behavior. You know, I think it's half the countries that attended the Summit of Democracy in the United States last year that are not fully on board with this agenda. So thinking about framing and trying to be as inclusive as possible as we enter this more contested period is what I would be looking for.
Minister, you have the last word.
Thank you. Well, for people who know Singapore, have dealt with us, you know we don't give advice. It's not in our, it's not in our DNA, and
except
we don't
privately.
We don't see that role. But I will tell you how we deal with not only Russia, but with countries that we engage. Find common ground. State your differences. You have to state them perhaps over a longer period. We don't shout them. We state them quietly. And when there are moments such as the Ukraine invasion, speak publicly, because you have to be counted to preserve the international order.
Thank you. I'm not going to try and summarize. We're already well late, but I just think we should show our appreciation to our truly, I think, extraordinary panelists, Bonnie Glaser, Raja Mohan, Defense Minister, and Natasha Kassam. Thank you so much.